Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Hope you guys are doing well, inshallah. So we're going to go ahead and I'll give you guys a couple of minutes to log on, or a minute to log on, inshallah, ta'ala, so that we can start. Okay. All right, 223 viewers. I guess once it hits about 332. All right, we're getting there, inshallah. 359. Okay, let's go ahead and start, inshallah. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. So, inshallah ta'ala, here we are. We're going to go ahead and continue now on Juz 11. And subhanallah, we're already one third done with the Qur'an. Think about that. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept your first third of Ramadan, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make your last two thirds even better than the first, and grant us all forgiveness, inshallah. So we're in Juz 11 now, and Juz 11 starts off with the end of Surah Al-Tawbah. So it goes from Surah Al-Tawbah, verse 93, all the way through Surah Yunus, and then through just the first five verses of Surah Hud. So primarily the meat of Juz 11 is really in Surah Yunus. So just to kind of let you guys understand how this comes together, Surah Al-Tawbah, which was again revealed at the at the very end of the prophetic mission in the ninth year after Hijrah, the second to last surah in its full entirety revealed to the Prophet ﷺ in its full entirety, and it literally is the highest point of Islam. Right, this is when Islam has spread through the earth. This is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put the Prophet ﷺ in a position now where he's dealing with the rest of the world. So this is the highest point of the deen. This is إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. This is when the victory of Allah has come and the conquest. So that's the highest point. Now right after Surah At-Tawbah, you're going to literally have the lowest point, which is Surah Yunus and Surah Hud, which is right before the Hijrah. So it's the end of Mecca. So the end of Mecca once again comes into play. So it kind of goes back to the context of Al-A'raf, which came just a few surahs before. And this is the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals with us in the Qur'an, right? It goes from the highest point to the lowest point, back to the highest point, back to the lowest point. So don't get too excited about the Battle of Badr, because there's still the Battle of Uhud. Learn your lessons. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking us from the highest point of Islam, which is 9 years after Hijrah, to the lowest point of Islam, which is right before the Hijrah, when the Prophet ﷺ is dealing with the most intense and severe persecution in Mecca, and he doesn't have much support at all as far as the people are concerned. And the benefit of this is, as opposed to a storybook, just going chronologically in the life of the Prophet ﷺ, is that this is how we are supposed to temper ourselves spiritually. This is how we discipline ourselves, that we don't get too elevated, because if we become too hopeful, then our hopefulness can become wishful thinking. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings us back down to fear. But if our fear becomes too much, then it becomes despair. So we're always to hover between hope and fear. We're always to look at what caused success in the past, and then what caused failure as well. So this is the way that the Qur'an sort of structures itself. So you've got Surah At-Tawbah, and then you've got the first two chapters in the Qur'an that are named after prophets. So Surah Yunus and Surah Hud are the first two chapters in the Qur'an that are named after prophets. Now, think about this. This is actually very, very, very cool. The first prophet that the Prophet ﷺ was informed about in the Qur'an was Yunus alayhi salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the story of Yunus alayhi salam in the first few revelations, or within the first few revelations, particularly where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Qalam, فَاصْبِرْ لِحُكْمِ رَبِّكَ وَلَا تَكُنْ كَصَاحِبِ الْحُوتِ إِذْ نَادَى وَهُوَ مَكْذُومٌ. that be patient with the command of your Lord, and don't be like the companion of the whale if he called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while he was already swallowed. So the first prophet that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was told about in the Qur'an was Yunus alayhi salam. The first surah in the Qur'an named after a prophet is Surah Yunus. It's once again named after Yunus alayhi salam. And Yunus, of course, is the prophet Jonah, peace be upon him. And there's a profound lesson in that, because Yunus alayhi salam, in him you have all of these different lessons. Yunus alayhi salam was successful, and then Yunus alayhi salam gave up, and so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused that harsh lesson to come to him. And then Yunus alayhi salam turned back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah elevated him. وَكَذَلِكَ نُنْجِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And as Allah says, and that's how we give salvation to the believers as well. So in the story of Yunus alayhi salam, you have the turns, right? And more likely than not, we will all have those turns in our life, in our lives. So this is a profound lesson for us, that Yunus alayhi salam is the first prophet that was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the first surah in the Qur'an named after a prophet is Surah Yunus. The reason why these two surahs in particular as well, Surah Yunus and Surah Hud, what unites Surah Yunus and Surah Hud with the Prophet ﷺ and the people of Mecca is that the people of Yunus and the people of Hud were idol worshippers, just like the people of Mecca. And they also rejected the notion of a hereafter. So the people of Yunus alayhi salam and the people of Hud alayhi salam, who were of course known as Ad, these were two peoples that worshipped idols, and they also reject the belief in the hereafter. So they're just like the people of Mecca in that sense. Now, one group was destroyed in the people of Ad. The other group would repent and re-welcome their prophet back in the people of Yunus alayhi salam. So again, you have the story of success and the story of failure. The people of Hud alayhi salam, Ad, were destroyed. And they were destroyed with violent winds. The people of Yunus alayhi salam, they repented to Allah. They welcomed Yunus alayhi salam back in their midst. And so here you really have the parallel of the people of Mecca in both situations. Some of the people of Mecca would be destroyed trying to kill the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and attacking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The likes of Abu Lahab and Abu Jahl and Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt and so on and so forth. The majority of them were destroyed in a humiliating fashion. They were disgraced because they sought to disgrace the Messenger of God and the believers. So they were destroyed. However, some of the people of Mecca lived on and repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they welcomed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam back into Mecca. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came home to Mecca to find his people upon belief after they had turned him out. So there are really a lot of parallels here that we see between the people of Yunus and the people of Ad, and Yunus and Hud themselves with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there's a lot of wisdom to them being mentioned first here. The theme also of Meccan Qur'an, the theme of Mecki Qur'an, is belief in the oneness of God and belief in the hereafter. Both are concepts that were rejected by the people of Yunus and the people of Hud alayhi salam. So it fits Mecki Qur'an as well, Meccan Qur'an as well. So that's sort of just to understand how this juz is put together, right? That's juz 11, and this is how it's put together. And you find the way that the surahs will be put together. Now, we left off last time with Surah At-Tawbah. The last verse of the last juz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions those people that came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that wanted to go out with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Tabuk, but they did not have the means to do so. But Allah recognized their hearts and He recognized their intentions, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted them the reward of that anyway. Okay, so إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ, that actions are but by intention. The way that Surah At-Tawbah starts off is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way that this juz starts off is verse 93, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions إِنَّمَا السَّبِيلُ عَلَى الَّذِينَ يَسْتَأْذِنُونَكَ وَهُمْ أَغْنِيَا, that the blame is upon those who seek your permission, who seek excuse, even though they are rich, so they have the means, but they stay back. رَضَوْا بِأَنْ يَكُونُوا مَعَ الْخَوَالِفِ, رَضَوْا بِأَنْ يَكُونُوا مَعَ الْخَوَالِفِ, they were pleased to be amongst those who stayed behind. وَطَبَعَ اللَّهُ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ فَهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sealed over their hearts, so they do not really know. And so here's a connection that you can make, inshallah ta'ala, to Surah Yunus. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions these people that were pleased with their wealth, and they were pleased to stay behind, and they were pleased to stay in their comfort and not deal with the hardship that was going to come with Tabuk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Yunus, لَا يَرْجُونَ لِقَاءَنَا وَرَضُوا بِالْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَاطْمَأَنُّوا بِهَا. So Allah will mention those who are pleased with the life of this world and who seek their tranquility in the life of this world. So there's actually a connection that that's already being made here. رَضُوا بِأَنْ يَكُونُوا مَعْ الْخَوَالِفِ. In Surah At-Tawbah, they were happy to stay behind. In Surah Yunus, رَضُوا بِالْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, they were pleased with the life of this world. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sanctions them once again. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in verse 100. So if you fast forward now to verse 100, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ. So the first forerunners in faith from the muhajirin and from the ansar. وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ. And those who followed them in their ihsan. So the people that came forth in faith, to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to support the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah says, those who follow them with bi ihsan, with excellence. Those who follow them with ihsan. We ask Allah to make us amongst them. Allahumma ameen. So it's actually beautiful here because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not exclude the listeners. Allah did not exclude those who are reading. So that you're reading about something that's distant or something that's in the past. Those who follow the example of the Ansar and the Muhajirin, radiyallahu anhum wa radu an. Allah is pleased with them, and they are pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَعَدَّ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي تَحْتَهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised for them gardens beneath which rivers flow, خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا, and they will abide therein forever. ذَلِكَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ. And this is the great attainment. This is actually, if you think about the end of Surah Al-Bayyinah, it pretty much is this ayah. The end of Surah Al-Bayyinah is pretty much this ayah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, those who strive for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is pleased with them, they are pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah has made them a promise, that they would be comforted on the Day of Judgment, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give them gardens beneath which rivers flow. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then brings back the two audiences, and this is common in the Qur'an, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the bushra to the believers, the glad tidings to the believers, and the punishment to the people who turn back. So in verse 105, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقُلِ اعْمَلُوا, and say, do what you will, do as you will. فَسَيَرَ اللَّهُ عَمَلَكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see your deeds, وَرَسُولُهُ, and his messenger, وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ, and the believers as well. So basically, go ahead and do what you will, but at the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see your deeds. And of course, those who lived in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would see their deeds, as would the believers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, says at the end of this ayah, وَسَتَرُدُّونَ إِلَىٰ عَالِمِ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَادَةِ فَيُنَبِئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. And then you will return to the knower of the unseen and the witnessed, and he will inform you of that which you used to do. So Allah sort of brings all these audiences together. The hypocrites who appeared to believe but did not really believe, so they stayed back. The believers who believed and they went forward, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewarded them. The believers witnessed what they did. The believers that had a sincere intention, but they were not able to go forth with the Prophet ﷺ because they did not have the means to do so. So Allah knows them and Allah will reward them. And those that stayed behind, the disbelievers that expressed both externally and internally animosity towards Allah and the Messenger ﷺ and the believers. So it will all come together, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inform you of that which you used to do. If you go to verse 111, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اشْتَرَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ بِأَنَّ لَهُمُ الْجَنَّةِ يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ فَيَقْتُلُونَ وَيُقْتَلُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that indeed Allah has purchased the believers, their lives, their properties, and in return for that, they will have paradise. And this is beautiful here because, as some of the scholars mentioned, that when you buy something cheap, you take the product and then you pay. But when you buy something expensive, you pay first and then you get the product. So in this situation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying the believers give themselves, they sacrifice themselves for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as a result, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them Jannah. بِأَنَّ لَهُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. Paradise is the return that comes as a result of that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the promise of the believers, the sacrifice of the believers. In this case, those who went out and those who were slain in the path of God. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the covenant that He took, fit Tawrati wal Injili wal Qur'an. So this is one of the few ayat in which you'll find Torah, Injil, and Qur'an all together. The Torah, the Gospel, and the Qur'an all together. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, all of you took this covenant with God, and whoever maintains that covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so rejoice in the transaction that you've contracted with Allah. وَذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ. And once again, that is the great attainment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who are these people that have given themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? At-Ta'ibun, Al-Abidun, Al-Hamidun, As-Sa'ihun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the believers that are repentant. At-Ta'ibun, Al-Abidun, those who are constantly worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who are constantly praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Hamidun, As-Sa'ihun, those who are going out for His cause, Al-Raki'un, those who are constantly bowing in prayer, As-sajidun, those who are prostrating in power. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm sorry, those who are prostrating and recognizing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's right upon them. Allah mentions as al-amiruna bil ma'rufi wa nahuna 'anil munkar, those who are enjoining good and those who are forbidding evil. Wal hafizuna li hududillah wa bashshiril mu'minin, and those who observe the limits set by God and give glad tidings to the believers. So this is sort of the way that Surah At-Tawbah goes through the believers, and it describes all these categories, and it really highlights who's on what side, right? Where everyone falls in this grand scheme of things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says about the Prophet sallallahu, he says about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam some beautiful things, and he says to the believers, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu taqullaha wa kunu ma'a sadiqeen. O you who believe, fear Allah and be amongst the truthful. Why is this important? As we said, Allah looks at the internal, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's internally in your hearts and what you're going to do for His sake and so on and so forth. But at the same time, this surah really talks about allying yourself with the right people as well. So allying yourself with the believers, keeping yourself surrounded with the truthful, not surrounding yourself with the hypocrites, because the hypocrites are clearly trying to pollute your faith and pollute your iman. So a person should keep themselves firm with as-sadiqeen, with those who are truthful to that covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it goes back to the company that you keep. So keep good company around you. People that will encourage you, people that will help you keep your intentions pure, keep people that will help you stay on the right path, and people that will always motivate you towards that which is good. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, ittaqullaha wa kunu ma'a sadiqeen. And a beautiful verse finally in Surah At-Tawbah, the last two verses, in fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُّمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, there has certainly come to you a messenger from among yourselves. It grieves him when you suffer. He has empathy. It grieves him when you suffer. حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. He is extremely concerned about you. بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. And to the believers, he's kind and merciful. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam here. That he cares about you, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam cares both about your worldly well-being and he cares about your well-being in the hereafter as well. He cares about your salvation as well. Why is this important in this surah and in this context in particular? Because the admonishing of the believers, or the admonishing of the hypocrites, or the admonishing of those who came behind, or the recognition of those who wanted to do good but did not have the means to do so. Allah and His Messenger want good for you. They want good for you. This is not to make a person feel heavy or to harm a person in any way. Allah and His Messenger want good for you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِن تَوَلُّوا. So if they turn away, despite that, despite the fact that they have a messenger amongst them, عليه الصلاة والسلام, who only wants good for them and wants to do well for them, if they turn away, فَقُلْ حَسْبِيَ اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ عَلَيْهِ تَوَكَلْتُ وَهُوَ رَبُّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمِ. This is the end of Surah At-Tawbah. If they turn away, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, say, sufficient for me is Allah. There is no deity except Him. On Him I have relied, and He is the Lord of the great throne. Basically, what this means is Allah did not need the hypocrites. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not need the hypocrites. Allah or the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam do not need insincere people. At the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who will give His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam victory and see him through these difficult moments and make things open up for him in a greater way. So subhanAllah, the last verse of Surah At-Tawbah is a verse of just place your trust in Allah and Allah will see you through it. And then Allah takes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam back to his most difficult days. He takes him back to Yunus alayhi salam. Right, Yunus alayhi salam, who maintained that tawakkul in his difficult, or who had tawakkul in his difficult time, and Allah saved him. And of course, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in his most difficult years, in the end of the Meccan period, when the persecution became most severe. So, if the people of Mecca turn away, if the people of Medina turn away, if the hypocrites turn away, whether it's good times or bad times for the ummah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see His Prophet through and He will see His believers through. So Surah Yunus now is what we come